go for it. And I titled the message, and I think it's going to be a little bit of a new series called What is Love? What is love? And up here it says in 1 John 4:10, this is real love. Not that we loved God, but He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sin. You know, last Sunday I was pretty open and transparent with you about what the Lord had done in my life the day before last Saturday, and I had a great week this week. It's been an awesome week this week. And I phrase it that way because I believe we all ought to be having a great week in the Lord. Amen? We ought to have great days in the Lord. But I think sometimes we look at great days as being, you know, everything's going smooth, I'm blessed, I'm excited. Man, it can't get no better than this. Like when I put on Facebook, I had liver and kefir for lunch the other day. Some of you kind of didn't approve of that, but it was good. So, you know, it's like, it ought to always be good, and I think we've been programmed to look at, if things are going smoothly in the natural, then it's good. Because in the natural, in a sense, I didn't have a great week. Well, I don't mean in the natural, but in the spiritual. Because see, after God spoke to me Saturday, and then I preached Sunday, and what I said, Mary was the foundation of my love, not God. Who's your source? Is he your source for finances? Is he the source of your love? Is he the source of the all in all? I mean, we say it, but I came to that realization personally, he wasn't. What didn't end there? You know, because then Sunday on the way home, you know, Sundays are interesting because usually in my house they're not empty, but this past Sunday it was empty. Everyone was gone. I was just there. So I'm like, okay, Lord, I want to know your love. I want to love like you love. I want to know it. Because I was still in a funky way Sunday. And then Monday I got up, went to the gym, did my normal stuff, and usually when I come back, I make coffee, and I sit down, and I start reading, and told you I'm reading Jim's book again, Taking Control of Your Life. And as I started reading it, he just really started speaking to me about stuff. I can tell you that, because that was personal. But I was crushed. I felt undone. So when I said to you, you need to open up your heart to the Lord and let Him minister to you, I knew what that felt like one day. It wasn't a pleasant feeling. But you know what? It's a whole lot better over here today. A whole lot different. A whole lot better. I wasn't purposely holding back stuff because I didn't know that was going on. He had to give me a revelation of that. You know what I mean? And he worked on me with that. And to the place, let me see what I wrote here. Because what I'm really referring to, I'm talking about when I say, I hope you had a great week, I mean, I'm referring to a time of transformation in your life. I'm talking about a time where you and the Spirit were being relational. A time of revelation. A time of repentance. A time of renewed peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's what I'm talking about saying, I hope you had a great week. Because again, we think a great week is nothing bad happened. Good. Made it through another week, or another day, or another hour, whatever it is. That's what we've been programmed to think. No. Is God doing a transforming work in your life? Are you changing? Are you being transformed into the image of Christ? Is that constantly going on? Are you just kind of stagnant? Are you all set? Are you just like, you've gone so far, and this is as far as you're going, because you know what, Lord? I ain't letting you touch that spot, and I certainly ain't going there, because if I go there, I'm going to have to repent. You know how to do that the other day. I had to get with somebody and repent before them. And again, what's repentance? Just change your mind. I said, you know what? I'm sorry, I was a jerk. When's the last time you sat down with somebody and looked at them and said, you know what? I'm sorry, I've been a jerk. You might say, wow, I'm not into that. No, again, it's not It's not what I did was what was important. It was the Spirit speaking to me. In fact, I wanted to get up with that person earlier than I did. I wanted to like do it then. Because I knew it had to be done. Because I knew if I'm holding on to stuff and I don't release it, it's going to continue to dog me. Because I was able to release that, it felt so much better. You know? And then I met up with someone else I hadn't seen in a while. I think it was Wednesday. Ended up doing that Tuesday. Wednesday I saw another person. I began to share with her the revelation I had about, you know, Mary being the foundation of love and what I preached, and you know how that was the first day in a long time I actually felt different on the inside. Because I felt dead, like there was this big hole, like I was sharing last Sunday. And the thing that was cool, she looked at me and said, you know what, you do seem different. I can tell you seem different. And I thought, you know what? That's awesome. I wasn't trying to put on anything. I wasn't doing anything. It was just great to see someone notice the difference from the last time I'd seen them, which was months before. And that's what I'm talking about. Is God doing a work in your life where you're being transformed? And again, in a sense, I want to say it's effortless transformation. It becomes more effortless the more you get involved in the process. But can you look back on last week and say, you know what? This week, I had a time with the Lord where I'm different than I was last week. And I was at a preacher conference Friday, and this guy was up preaching, and he gave this verse, and it just kind of stuck in my craw. And this is my introduction, but I feel I need to. This is important, because guys, if we're not doing this, what's the point? If we're not allowing the Spirit of God to transform us, why do you hear? Why do you read the Bible? Why do you pray? Why do you do anything? You know, the preacher conference I went to was really cool in the sense that the first thing this bishop from Oklahoma got up and said, you know what, because he was preaching to all preachers. All preachers and spiritual leaders there. He said, you know what we always do is we always turn the mirror of the people and say, you need to look into the Word of God. He said, when was the last time you turned the mirror around and looked at yourself? And I said, you know what? We need to do that. And I just sat there and smiled, and I said, 4 years ago, I started on that journey. 4 years ago now. I only know that because my kids weren't sober that long, and that's when it started, right at that time. When I got that book that I'm rereading that I got 4 years ago, and he's still speaking to me more stuff. That's when I started that journey of really looking on the inside to find out what, you know, where am I in my relationship with God? You know, examine yourself to see if you're truly in the faith. You know, yeah, I'm born again, but no. Am I walking? Am I living? Am I demonstrated? Is it naturally flowing, or do I have to make an effort in everything I do for the Spirit of God to flow through? So this verse, the other guy said, was found in Romans 14, 17. You can turn there if you like. I don't have it. It's the one slide. It's just up there. It says, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. And I think we missed that. The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. We'll get to the rest of the verse in a second. But to me, when I looked at that, it said the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. Eating and drinking to me is symbolic of this realm. This is not the kingdom of God. Okay? I don't really think we put so much emphasis, so much work, so much energy into this natural realm that I think we're missing it. This is not the kingdom. This is the world system. Not the kingdom. He said, the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. The kingdom of God is not your job. It's not your house. It's not your vehicle. It's not your kids. It's not anything. This is not the kingdom of God. But what is the kingdom of God? He goes on and says, but. So whenever you see a but, what do? Throw away what you just read, because this is the boring part, right? The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. It's not about this natural realm, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's what the kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God is righteousness. Are you righteous? Yes. Positionally, let me ask you throughout practically. Are you walking in your righteousness? Is your attitude that I'm going to walk righteous? Now again, that's going to look different for everybody, isn't it? It's not a one size fits all. But is your attitude, I'm going to walk righteous today, whatever that looks like for me. Not only that, peace. You got peace. I mean, real peace that the Bible says passes all understanding. Because if you're confused, you're not in peace. Because His peace passes all understanding. See, when we get wrapped up in the natural realm with the eat and drink and all that stuff, it creates confusion. It's a distraction, and the devil knows that. And he wants to use that to rob your peace. He wants to use that to get you to walk outside of righteousness so that you begin to incorporate the principles of the world and get you wrapped back up in them. Because in the world, there is no peace. There is no joy. World system. I'm talking about sin, the world system that we've been programmed with. So peace and joy. What's the joy of the Lord? Strength. Feeling weak? Feel like you can't do stuff? It's like you're feeling wiped out? No, no, no. The joy of the Lord's my strength. I can do it. I do it out of joy. Not because I have to or want to. So again, we are kingdom kids. We are living as kingdom kids. We are to be experiencing the realities of kingdom living here on earth. Yes, we are to experience the reality of kingdom living here on earth. But unfortunately, we've been taught that if we live right or righteously, that proper performance, then in our daily life, we'll be right. And we can expect the results of that performance. That's why some people get confused. How come I'm not seeing this in my life? How come I know the Word of God here, but it ain't happening? Are you walking in the kingdom? We understand we're kingdom kids, right? Yep. You born again?
Yep.
You're a kingdom kid. You're not of this world. This world is not your home. You're part of the kingdom. You're seated in heavenly places right now in the right hand of God. Right. We're seated in heavenly places. You're a kingdom kid. So a kingdom kid functions how? In righteousness, peace, and joy. So, let me remind you, where is the kingdom right now?
In us.
There you go, the kingdom's right in us. See, because Luke 17, 21, Jesus said, though will they say, see here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you. Now, a lot of the other translations will say the kingdom of God is among you, and honestly, that's a better translation. Because at that time Jesus said it, you know, he hadn't ascended to heaven yet, he didn't have the indwelling Holy Spirit. So yes, the kingdom of God was among them. Why? He was the only kingdom kid at the time. He was the only person who was a human being filled with the Spirit of God at the time. Nobody else was, just Jesus. So actually the kingdom was among them, the kingdom was him. But the kingdom was still in him. Well, now when we fast forward here, are we in the kingdom? Yeah, we're on the side of the cross. The Spirit of God now indwells us, just like it did Jesus. So living in the kingdom, we want to be functioning as kingdom kids, walking in the blessing of the kingdom. Now, how do you comprehend that or perceive that kingdom principle? Because it's kind of different for everyone. There's one matter, one truth remains in that. The kingdom is inside of us. And unless a transformation occurs by the Spirit, which dramatically affects your soul to the place it creates a new heart belief, you will never experience kingdom realities in this present reality. That was worth the price of admission right there. I'm supposed to say that's a good word, preacher. It's a hard word, but it's a good word. Unless you're transformed. See, so many people are constantly confused, saying, why does the Word of God say one thing and I'm experiencing another thing in my life? Why is this happening? By His stripes I'm healed, why ain't I healed? prosper as your soul prospers. Why ain't it prospers? Why am I struggling with all these things? Why am I always seem to be wrestling with the same stuff? Because you're looking at this realm as proof that kingdom reality stuff works. Can I say again? I've said it many, many times. You get in this world exactly what you believe. That's what you get. You get what you believe because you know how to function no other way. We've been designed that way. So what's it come down to? Belief. That's why I said, unless the Holy Spirit transforms you and creates a new heart belief in that particular area you're confused about or struggling with, it will never change in your life. I don't care how many times you quote the scriptures. I don't care how much you meditate on the scriptures. See, what we've done is taken the process that helps us write a new heart belief and think because I did not follow the process or I did follow the process, then it doesn't work. No, it only works when a transformation occurs. You know, if I got a revelation that my foundation of love was not based in God, it was not based in Christ, it was based in Mary. Great, got the revelation. What if I didn't do nothing about it? A lot of people get that. Get a revelation, but you don't walk it through and allow it to transform you to the place where you know you transform when other people see it. And you're like, I didn't do nothing. I didn't do anything to bring about the transformation that's there. Nothing. I acknowledged it. I had to change my mind about some things. I had to go to a person and talk to them. And then the very next day, somebody said, man, you're different. I'm like thinking, I ain't no different. I woke up today, went to the gym, worked out, came home, got my coffee, read, took a shower, now I'm here. You're no different. See, transformation brings out a difference that others will see. You know, Kerry Blake made a statement in the DHT. We haven't heard it yet where we are. I think he made it in the New Man, but if you've already gone through the DHT, you heard it. Remember he made this statement. He says, you've got to get someone 70% healed on the inside before it manifests out on the outside. And then it was confused me. What the heck is he talking about? What's he talking about? I get it now. The guy is being transformed on the inside. And once he hit that 70% mark of transformation, the rest was easy. It was just a little step. So I'm beginning to understand this. When it comes to dealing with people and dealing with healing, deliverance, bondages, strongholds, whatever wrong words you want to throw out there. When it comes to dealing with lost people, they have no faith. Have no belief. They got nothing. You know what? I get the Spirit of God and I can put it right into them. Get this analogy this morning. It might not work for you, but it works for me. It's just like a car without a battery. It's dead. Car's dead without a battery. Who's the battery? Me. I walk up, tap into that car, boom, it starts up. You walk up to a lost person, dead, they ain't got no battery. Man, you touch them, they feel the power of God. They feel, wow, they get charged. They get, things happen in them, right? You get a car with no battery, it does nothing. You put a battery in it, turn the key, it does something. So where's the battery? Touch that last person, cast out demons, lay hands on the sick. Yeah. Why? We got life, they don't. They didn't trespass and sins, right? We got the life of Christ in us. So can we go up to a lost person and make a difference right off the bat? Yeah. Can they feel it, know it right off the bat? Yeah, many times they do. Many times they just weed it out when you're around. There's something about you, and I don't know what that is. Ever had that happen? You didn't say nothing to nobody. You just go by, and they're like looking at you weird, like, I'm not sure I want to get near that person. It's the power of emanating. They know. They might not understand, but they know you got something they ain't. Then we do. Don't make us better. Just makes us different, right? born again, filled with the Spirit, they ain't. They can have what we got. That's what we need to be telling them. Amen. That's the good news. But now what happens when you run into a Christian? You know what a Christian is? He's got the battery, don't he?
Yeah.
He's got the battery. He's the car. He's got the battery. But what's the matter with his battery? It's weak. It's run down. The stones of life have drained him down, like we get around here in the cold. You know, it starts a little hotter in the cold. Why? Just the heaviness, just the stuff. What do we do as believers? We come alongside and help impart into. Are we better? No. We different? No. We're the same thing. So we can help put in life, but we don't give them something they don't have. That's where this codependency thing comes with, especially with healing. I gotta go to the healer because he's got what I need. No, we don't. You got what you need. The problem is you need to be transformed in renewing your mind in that area so you can experience it for yourself. Because you're not doing any internal examination saying, you know what, God? The Word says this. Why ain't I seeing it? The Spirit of God says, this is why. And you're like, oh, don't go there. No, no, no. I'm locking that door. You ain't getting in there. That's where the freedom is. That's where we got to let him in. How about we let someone in that loves us unconditionally, has nothing but good things for us? Let them in. So for us, we need to be mindful of this process of transformation and be involved in it all the time. See, well, let me follow this before I get way off on this. If you look at my notes, you're like, what the heck is he talking about? Because he ain't even on the page. Yeah, I'm starting to come up. This is probably all we're going to go. I ain't even into the sermon today. It'll be just in the introduction. So let me ask you, did you have a personal time with the Holy Spirit this week? I'm not talking about, did you sit down and read your Bible? Did you open a little devotional book you bought, Our Daily Bread, and spend 10 minutes with God and have a cup of coffee? But that's what we've been taught. We think that's something. Now we're driving to work and we get the prayer list and we're checking off names. You know. And we go to Bible studies and we do all this stuff, or we go out in the community and do things because we think we're supposed to. No. Did you spend time with God? So I put it this way. Did you have a time of revelation? And again, let's not get weirded out about revelation. The word simply means an unveiling. Saw something you didn't see before. You know, like the covering came off your eyes and you could see clearly about that particular thing. Did you get a revelation this week? Did that lead you to repentance? And what I mean, change your mind about the thing. You saw that certain thing a certain way because you were blinded. Now your eyes have been opened and you see it differently, so now you've got to repent, change your attitude towards that thing, because now you see clearly. You know, that song, it's going through my head. I can see clearly now, the rain is gone. Sorry, but it was going through my head. And you see clearly now, why? It's been lifted. So now that I see clearly, I have to repent because I'm not over there seeing dimly anymore, I'm seeing clearly. So I got to repent from what I thought was right, and now I go this way. And that brought about a new heart belief, which we understand to be transformation. If that's all that occurs, what's the point? Because you're going to drift back into darkness unless you take the proper steps to now meditate on that new truth. Now get scripture on that new truth. Now focus on that new truth. Because if you don't and you leave that void, you're naturally going to float back over there and get wrapped up in darkness, and that stronghold is going to get even stronger again. See, people are worried all about that scripture. You know, you cast out a demon and that seven demons come back even worse. No, no, no. Old Testament, get past that. This is how it applies today. You had a stronghold. The Spirit of God gave you revelation to that stronghold. You saw the light. But you didn't repent, change your mind, you didn't start walking in the newness of the revelation you got, and you drifted back over here, and you got even deeper into bondage. That's what happened. Because you know what? If there are demons attached to your strongholds, when you walk in the light, they flee. When you repent, they flee. You know, it's good just to have stuff fall off. Effortless transformation is what happens. Because sometimes we got to come alongside and help, sure. So I pray we all break free from the religious activities of prayer and Bible reading and studying, going into the community to do good works, and we come into the place of relational transformation by His Spirit that dwells in us. We need to come into a relational transformation. And I think that's what I was saying. Remember last Sunday I was saying I had a bad week? I just felt, I wouldn't hear from God. It was just a different week. I didn't realize that now I'm in a place of constant revelation just to say that, because I'm really focusing on my relationship with Him, that when it wasn't there, it was weird. It was like, wow. You know, I'm getting stuff now that I'm preaching I didn't think of. In revelation now, I got revelation this morning, sitting down, going over this, drinking coffee. I guess that sermon must have been for me, because you got none of it. You didn't get nothing I got this morning. I don't remember it. I just remembered. You see what I put on Facebook? Man, I'm fired up. I'm ready. I'm like, Spirit of God was still on me. And that's what's awesome. That's how it's supposed to happen with all of us. You sit down with the Word, or you take a book or whatever, you know, a religious book that has religious things in it, you know, like gyms or curry stuff or whatever, and whatever tickles your fancy. If Andrew does, awesome, you know. Creflo does. I had the preacher Friday ask me, the bishop guy was kind of overseeing the meeting I was at. He said, so how'd you come to the fullness of faith, become Pentecostal? I said, well, watch a Creflo Dollar. That's a word from Abe. You know, that's what spurred me to that place that got me out of that darkness. Then I got into that revelation, but if I just stopped there and didn't walk through it, you know, where would I have been? Still back there. Embedded deeper. So, let me just comment on this a minute, then we'll get done early, can hang out, have some fellowship, and not be rushing to do the thing, because I don't want to start into it. But you know what? There is a real love that we can have. Because after I started saying, you know what, I was saying to God, God, I want to know your love. I want to know your love. So He gave me a revelation on that. He actually gave me a couple practical steps that I needed to do. I said, okay, I want to involve repentance and then doing it. But again, I'm not doing it because I'm supposed to. I understand the scripture He showed me, and it's part of the process. You know, trying to understand, I don't need to control the process. I don't want to control the process. I may not understand the process. The process may look like that ain't never going to work. I'm getting out of that. I'm saying, okay, God, you spoke to me. You showed me this. I'm going to walk this way. And honestly, the way I'm walking right now, praise God, the person who kind of walked with it is just a very godly person, and it's a real blessing. Because that person said to me, in some of our conversations, said, you know what? If this is where God's leading you, it ain't going to hurt you again. I went, wow. Wow. That was the wow. God can say it. And I'm telling you that for this reason, I think. When you open up your heart to God and you want to follow where He's leading you, the first thing the devil throws back in your mind, if you go back down that road, you think you're hurt again. So last time you walked that road, you got hurt. Don't you dare open that up again. You're going to be hurt. And that's why what that person said to me was just such an awesome, it just like, I knew it said love, but it was a slap upside the head. It was like, bam! Get out of your Polish mode. Wake up! That's what God said to you, and He only has good things for you, then you're going to get hurt going down that road. Yeah, you're right. This is scary. In the natural, it's scary. Know what I mean? And I'm sharing that because that's where some of you are right now. God just gave me that word. Some of you are at that place. He spoke to you this morning. And like, I don't know if I can open that back up, Lord. I don't know if I can love again. I don't know if I can give myself to someone else again. I don't know if... There's only two things he said, so I'm going to stop there. Because you know, the last person I did that to, I got really hurt. I got hurt bad. I don't want to feel that again. You'll never feel pain like, and somebody can relate to this, I'm not saying for an emotional effect, but please don't get emotional over it. You will, at least for me so far, I've never felt the pain in my life as deeply as losing your soulmate. That was so deep. Now, I'm not talking about the degree of pain, I'm just talking the depth of it. It was like, wow, I didn't know I could feel that deep, you know? And sometimes, so it's like, don't go back there, God. Like I said last week, Lord, I want to know your love as deeply as I feel this pain. It wasn't peace. Like I said, he showed me that. And then he showed me a prescription. Okay, son, if you want to know it that deep, this is what you need to walk out. And I'm like, thank God for that godly person who gave me that word. I don't even know if they knew what they had said. It was like, yeah. Going to go there. Because you know what? When you're closed up, you can only give out what you're going to let out. And if there's areas that are closed up, you can't give out in that area. You can't touch a life in that area. So if you're closed up in finances, in love, in peace, whatever, it ain't going to flow out. You know what? At this point in my life, I want the fullness of it all. He said, I got it all. I want to know the fullness of love and joy. And peace. Amen. And righteousness.
Amen. Amen.
Some kingdom kid.
Amen.
Comes with the package.
Alright.
And the thing that's limiting the package is me.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And the thing that's been limiting my package is my heart beliefs. And being able to push through some of the hurts and pains you had over your life. So you know what, God, you are good. You are awesome. And you're right, you're never going to lead me into a place that will bring me pain. It doesn't mean I won't go through things. You know what I mean? I'm starting to understand, and this is a little bit of the message, we'll get it next week. One thing you got to destroy is this saying that I had ingrained in me. Love is not a feeling, it's an act of your will. That's a lie from the devil. Love is a feeling. The other thing is, these are two things he showed me. I'll just give you the bullet points, and we'll talk about them next week. The other thing, when I kept asking him, God, what is love? What is it equal to? He gave me an equation. He said, love equals value. You love what you value. If you want to leave that with you, chew on it. And also 1 Corinthians 13 again. There's no pain in love. If you're operating out of the love of God, no one can ever hurt you. You don't hurt love. Why? Because love overlooks this. Love doesn't feel bad. Love's not envious. None of that stuff we read and try to comprehend, but you know what? When the foundation is love, when you put value another person or another thing or whatever, we say we love that. You know what? God so valued the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God values people. That's why it breaks my heart to see, kind of like a Planned Parenthood has done, and all the people talking about that, you have completely devalued humanity. Forget the abortion stuff. Forget all that stuff. I don't care. When you can look at a human being who God sent his son to die for, God placed that kind of value on you and me, that he was willing to give up his own offspring to get us back. That's a pretty high value. Don't ever allow anyone to devalue you. You are precious in his sight. You are awesome. You are loved. You are accepted. You are not what anyone else says. You are his crowning jewel. He's going to elevate all of us for all eternity as a display of his mercy and glory. We, humanity, is valuable. So first value yourself, and then as we look others. That's what I've been telling God. God, I want to see people as you see them. I want to feel what you feel for other people. Those were a few more than the bullet points, but that, we're going to dig it out a little bit more next week, so. Ask him this week for revelation, will you? Do you know what? An old song we used to sing from that time, search me, O God, know my heart. He knows it. So you know what, God? As you search my heart, show me what you see. I know I'm not wicked and sinful. That's not what I'm asking. But what are those areas I'm holding back on? What are those things I'm not fully trusting you in? What are those things that are really my foundation that I'm of you? Because if I'm going to walk in the fullness of this thing, you know what? Honestly, right now, my life's pretty good. Having fun. Things are great. Prosperous. Do the works of Jesus. Lay hands on the sick, see if we recover. Things are good. But you know what? They can be better. I'm not walking in the fullness. I know that. And unless his kids, and I really think he wants to do it us here, unless us, he gets a group of kids that are interdependent, walking in his fullness, we're not going to see what people call a revival around him. We're not going to see it. He's not holding back. He's not waiting to come and sweep through. He's waiting for us to get rid of those strongholds that are holding us back from walking in the fullness of manifestation of the sons of God that we know we are. It says in Romans, the earth is groaning, waiting for the manifestations of the sons of God. We are the sons. We have it. It's got to be more than this thing of comprehending and understanding it. It's got to get to the place where we break off the junk and feel free. Yes, independence is awesome. But feel free to be interdependent. Walk in that fullness, unafraid. Touch lives, amen.
Hallelujah.
That's what he wants to bring us. So now, what we all need to do, maybe tomorrow morning, shaving, brushing your teeth, doing whatever, washing your face, and look in the mirror, and turn the mirror back on you. Say, God, show me my heart. Whatever works for you, show me what's holding me back from walking in your fullness. Because you know what? The kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. If you're not walking in that, you ain't got it. I want that all the time. Amen? Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Worship you and honor you. Praise you. Lord, I just thank you the way you blessed me, because I have no idea where that was and come from. But Lord, you blessed me and spoke to me some more stuff. Because Lord, I don't want to hold back anything. I don't want to hold back anything. It's one thing to be able to share. It's one thing to be transparent, Lord. But it's another not to let you in. Because sometimes we think sharing is letting you in. No, no, no. To tell what you've given that nobody else knows but you if I'm walking it out. So Lord, help us all to do that. I know you spoke to hearts this morning. I know you touched, because you would have told me those things if that's not what you wanted to do. But Lord, now it's up to us as kingdom kids to truly experience the Holy Spirit, that relationship where we walk in our righteousness, not just understand it positionally, declare it boldly. Yes, we need to do all that. We are righteous. We are the righteousness of Christ. But Lord, show us how to practically walk that out, because we get a lot of strongholds, footprints.
Yeah.
Or as we've read, a lot of footprints in our hearts. People have walked over us. In these areas, we've not allowed people to go, but Lord, that turned into not letting you go there either. So bust through all that this morning. Radically change us. That even this morning, as revelation knowledge is flowing, transformation is occurring. And throughout this week, Lord, may you just crush us in a good sense. May we understand what's going on. Because, Lord, this Sunday is a whole lot better than last Sunday. But I had to go through last Saturday and Sunday to get here. Because you're a good God. You only have good things for me. You only have fullness of joy and blessing and riches. But Lord, that's not going to come on the outside. It'll happen on the inside. Because the kingdom is within. So Lord, I thank you and worship you and honor you. Pray that your blessing fall upon each and every one of us. And your spirit guide us into all truth throughout this week. We honor you now in Jesus' name. Amen.